One of the great strengths of democracy is that bad policies are often reversed. That's a consolation when we look at the flurry of pandering programs being enacted as the populist wave works its way through the Western world. When a new government is elected, much of this can be undone, except for Brexit, which, if it goes through, might prove to be the most profound and lasting legacy of this decade. Britain, famous for its prudence, propriety, and punctuality, is suddenly looking like a banana republic as it makes reckless decisions, misrepresents reality, and now wants to change its own self-imposed deadline. As Martin Sanbu writes in the Political Quarterly, Brexit has always been a solution in search of a problem. To me, the best evidence of this is that Britain's Eurosceptics generally want to leave the EU because they see it as a statist juggernaut. But in virtually every other member country, Eurosceptics see the EU as a free market juggernaut. That's why they don't like it. So either all those other countries, 27 countries, have it backwards, or Britain's Conservative Party has gone nuts. When I asked Anne Applebaum last week how historians would understand the road to Brexit, she suggested that it all centers around the Conservative Party. The Tories could probably claim to be the most significant political party of the 20th century, governing Britain for most of that period, producing Churchill, Thatcher, and other iconic Western statesmen. But after the Cold War, as left-wing parties abandoned socialist ideas and moved to the center, the right faced an identity crisis. In America, this mobilized the Republicans to emphasize social and cultural issues like abortion, gay rights, and immigration. In Britain, Tories found themselves in the same mushy middle that Prime Ministers Tony Blair and David Cameron inhabited. So, as Applebaum noted, they went radical on Europe. We're all weary of the drama.
Of the contrary, no!
No!
Division! Clear the lobby!
But keep in mind, Brexit will be a disaster. As Sanbu points out, Britain's economy is competitive and productive only in high-value manufacturing and in services, both of which depend on a deeply integrated market within Europe. The foreign policy impact of Brexit might prove to be even more consequential. Within a few years, Scotland and Northern Ireland will probably loosen their ties to Britain in order to maintain their association with Europe. The United Kingdom will then be reduced to just England and tiny Wales. London, a city that has shaped global affairs for 250 years, will become the West's Dubai, a place where lots of money sloshes around, but of no great geopolitical consequence. Europe will also lose a lot with Brexit. Britain is a big, vibrant economy. It's been a crucial voice in the community for free markets, openness, efficiency, and an outward-looking foreign policy. It has a powerful army that it deploys. As non-Western countries like China rise, the central question of international relations is, can the international system built by the West that has produced peace and prosperity for 75 years last? Or will the rise of China and India and the revival of Russia erode it and return us to what Robert Kagan calls the jungle of international life, marked by nationalism, protectionism, and war? The world order as we know it was built over two centuries during the reigns of two liberal Anglo superpowers, Britain and the United States. Brexit will mark the end of Britain's role as a great power. And I wonder whether it will also mark the day that the West, as a political and strategic entity, began to crumble. For more, go to cnn.com/Fareed and read my Washington Post column this week.